So the last video covered the basics of pipelining, and I talked about how you can take, one large monolithic task and break it up into three stages, as I'm showing over here. And I also ended the discussion by saying that pipelining does introduce certain overheads, and that's what I'm going to cover in this video. And it essentially boils down to understanding the role of clocks and latches in a microprocessor pipeline. Okay, so in this example, I'm going to assume that an instruction goes through a two-stage pipeline in some processor. And I'm showing, stage one and stage two over here. And let's assume that in stage one, I do, certain operations like fetch. Then I decode the instruction, which is, trying to figure out exactly what this instruction is trying to do and what operands it needs. And then I also go ahead and get those operands. And then in stage two, I actually do the execute. So if it's an add, this is where I do the actual math. And then I also, write the result into some register entry, right? So those are the two, those are the activities being performed in stage one and stage two. Okay, so let's go through an example. Let's say that instruction one is doing an add of, R1 plus R2 and writing the result to R3. Okay, and in this example, let's just say that it so happens that R1 is the number one, is a number five, and R2 is a number seven. Okay, so during the first cycle, right? So in the operations being done in stage one, I first fetch the instruction, I figure out, oh, this is an add, it needs R1 and R2. Let me fetch R1 and R2 from the register file, and those numbers end up being 5 and 7. Okay, so at the end of the first cycle, the numbers 5 and 7 show up on the outputs of stage one, right? That's what I've been able to do in stage one. And those outputs are now being fed as inputs to stage two. Okay, so in the second cycle, stage two is going to see its inputs as, 5 and 7, and it's going to get to work on those. It's going to start adding those two numbers up. So here is where I perform, 5 plus 7, produce a result 12. And towards the end of that cycle, 12 will get written into R3. Okay, so while stage two is doing its operations, note that stage one has moved on to fetching the second instruction, right? So it might have started working on instruction two, which let's assume is, add of R4 plus R5, writing the result into R6. And let's just say that R4 and R5 happen to be the numbers 8 and 9. Okay, so while stage two is doing its work, stage one is fetching this instruction, and somewhere in the middle of that cycle, its outputs are going to start changing. Instead of 5 and 7, it'll now have the values 8 and 9 on these wires. And if these output signals of stage 1 are directly connected to the input signals of stage 2, 5 and 7 are soon going to be changing, right? So in the middle of the cycle, in the middle of stage 2's math and writing into register R3, its inputs are going to be in flux. And that means the math that it performs is also going to be unpredictable, right? While you're doing 5 and 7, if your inputs start to change, it's not clear what your output result is going to be, right? And this is a bad thing. So while stage 2 is doing its operations, it needs to have constant inputs. Its inputs can't be changing. And those inputs will change if you directly connect the outputs of stage 1 to the inputs of stage 2. And this is why we need to decouple stage 1 and stage 2 with what is called a latch. Okay, so what exactly is a latch? So a latch is a circuit which has an input, could have multiple inputs if you wanted, and it has an output, and it has a clock input as well. Okay, so on every rising clock edge, the latch samples whatever value is on its input, stores that in its output, and retains that value on the output until it encounters the next rising clock edge, right? So when it encounters this rising clock edge over here, there's, let's say, a 5 on the input, and so a 5 gets stored in the output, and that value stays constant until you see the next rising clock edge. So the next rising clock edge, maybe the input has changed to an 8 and might have changed long back, but that does not influence the output. It's only at the rising clock edge that the latch inspects its input, says, oh, my input is 8, so correspondingly I'll make my output 8 as well, and so 5 becomes an 8 at this point and stays constant until you encounter the next rising clock edge, right? So this is a great way to make sure that the inputs to stage 2 don't change. If the inputs are coming from a latch, we know that those inputs are guaranteed to be constant until the next clock edge, right? So this is what the circuit might finally look like, right? So you have stage one, it terminates in a latch, and then you have stage two, which also terminates in a latch, right? And so at every rising clock edge, the outputs of stage one get latched in, and they serve as a constant input to stage two for the entire duration of cycle two. Okay, so you know, let me just again go through an example over here where, so you know, in cycle one, which is a rising clock edge over here, rising clock edge over here, and so you have, you know, instruction one sitting in stage one, and then you have the next clock edge over here. At this point, instruction one has now graduated to stage two, and that allows, you know, stage one to start fetching instruction two, right? And then as you go through the next clock cycle, since this is a two-stage pipeline, instruction one has finished, right? So that it's done. And so it leaves the pipeline. So instead, what you have in cycle three is instruction two working on stage two, and instruction three now enters stage one, and so on. Okay. So I also mentioned that there's a certain overhead being introduced by latches. So let's try to understand that overhead now. Okay, so let me erase this ink over here. So, you know, if you have an unpipelined processor, let's say something like this, even an unpipelined processor is going to terminate in some kind of latch, right? So there's going to be a clock provided at the very end, which allows all of these results to be saved in some kind of latch or register, okay? And so let's say that, you know, this unpipelined processor took, say, 6 nanoseconds to do all of its operations. And then ultimately, you know, latching a result also takes some time, right? You know, once some value has been produced at the end of 6 nanoseconds over here, it takes, you know, let's say an additional 0.2 nanoseconds to store that result in some kind of latch register. Okay, so essentially my cycle time has to be long enough to let all of this operation finish, right? So there's a rising clock edge here, a rising clock edge over here, and the gap between consecutive rising clock edges needs to be 6.2 nanoseconds, enough time to do the actual circuit work and enough time to store that result in some kind of latch. Okay, so as a result, my cycle time for my unpipelined processor is 6.2 nanoseconds. And the corresponding clock speed is 1 by 6.2 nanoseconds, which, you know, is in the neighborhood of, you know, 160 megahertz. Okay, now in this design, I've broken up, you know, this 6 nanosecond work into two stages, right? So I'm going to do 3 nanoseconds worth of work over here, 3 nanoseconds worth of work over here, you know, plus it's 0.2 nanoseconds to store the result in a latch, likewise over here. Right, so now my clock has to be, you know, long enough to do the work and the latching. So it has to be, you know, 3.2 nanoseconds, this gap. Right, so in my two-stage pipeline, cycle time is 3.2 nanoseconds, and the clock speed is 1 by 3.2 nanoseconds. Which I believe is, you know, I think 312.5 megahertz. Okay, so I'm not being very precise with my math over here, but you can see that the cycle time has not quite halved. It's not gone from 6.2 to 3.1 because of the overheads being introduced by every single stage. And so as you go from two stages to four stages, again, the cycle time is not quite going to halve, right? So those are the overheads being introduced by clock speed. So if I go from an unpipelined processor to a processor that has 10 stages, my clock speed is not going to go up by a factor of 10. It'll be a little less than that. Okay, so here are some equations to kind of just keep in mind. So in my unpipelined processor, you know, the time it takes to execute one instruction could be, you know, T, which is all of the circuit time, plus the overheads for, you know, one latch register at the very end. For an n-stage pipeline, the time it takes per stage is, you know, that circuit time T, which has now been equally divided into n stages, so T by n, and then the overhead for the latching, right? And I'm assuming over here that I can do perfect pipelining where I can have, you know, n stages where each stage does exactly the same amount of work. And now, if you look at the total time it takes to finish one instruction, it is, T, which is a circuit time, plus, because of the n pipeline stages, I have, n times T overhead, which is the time to, where T overhead is the time to latch, is a time for one latch to do its work. So the net result is that my clock cycle time is T by n plus T overhead. Clock speed is the inverse of that. And the speed up through pipelining is essentially the ratio of the old cycle time and the new cycle time. So the old cycle time used to be T plus T overhead. That's what I'm showing over here. And the new cycle time is T by n plus T overhead, right? And if if you try out a few values for n, T, and T overhead, you'll see that the ideal speed up is not quite n. It's a little less than n. But as a result of pipelining, the number of cycles that it takes to complete one instruction is n, because each instruction has to go through n different stages, and so that takes n cycles. But on average, there's one instruction that is leaving the processor every single cycle. So if I looked at my processor for a million cycles, nearly a million instructions are going to leave the pipeline in that time. So on average, it takes only one cycle to graduate each new instruction. Right, and that's what CPI is, cycles per instruction, which is, what is the average number of cycles it takes between the successive graduations of instructions? And that happens to be one, right? So, do note the distinction between these two over here. One instruction will take n cycles to finish because it has to go through n stages. But on average, there's one instruction leaving the pipeline every single cycle. Okay, so having gone through these basics, I'll next walk through a simple five-stage pipeline in the next video.